Now we are live on Facebook. Good evening, everybody, and welcome to today's session. And today's Karwan special lecture is on calligraphical elements in Sanskrit inscriptions. And to talk about this, we have Dr. T.S. Ravishankar, an expert in the field. He was born in the year 1955. Dr. Ravishankar had his first MA in Sanskrit and the second MA in Ancient History and Archaeology, and did his PhD from the University of Mysore. Having joined the epigraphy branch of the ASI as an epigraphical assistant, he has served for more than 35 years in different positions and gradually risen up to the position of head of the branch. He retired as the director of epigraphy from ASI Mysore. He is the executive member of the Epigraphical Society of India, chairman of Place Name Society of India, and vice president of South Indian Numismatic Society. Dr. Ravishankar has established his expertise in deciphering ancient Sanskrit inscriptions and also early coins. And presently, apart from the editing of annual reports on Indian epigraphy, Dr. Ravishankar has worked as an expert numismatic from the Archaeological Survey of India at Delhi Customs Office to examine the coins. For last more than 26 years, he has been teaching the students of postgraduate diploma in archaeology at the Institute of Archaeology, ASI New Delhi, and he has coordinated and conducted many workshops on paleography, epigraphy, and numismatics at Delhi and Mysore. He was also the general president for the Epigraphical Society of India annual session at Dharwar 2016. And we are truly honored and delighted to host Dr. Ravishankar this evening on Karwan to talk about calligraphical elements in Sanskrit inscriptions. So, without further ado, I formally invite Dr. Ravishankar to deliver today's Karwan special lecture. Over to you, sir.
Good evening to Ishan Sharma ji for having introduced me and the viewers. I'm extremely happy when I placed the proposal that I would like to give a talk on some aspect connected with epigraphy and paleography. Sharma ji immediately agreed, and the first thing struck me is, though it is first time, I want to make a foray into a little unknown area, calligraphical elements in Sanskrit inscriptions. I was a bit careful while giving the title. I didn't call it calligraphy in Sanskrit inscription, calligraphical elements in Sanskrit inscriptions. And this is an area which deserves much attention. In the epigraphical studies, you know, normally the students and scholars, they go directly to the text of the inscription and the historical facts hidden or in the inscription. Rarely they go to the facsimiles of the inscription or the text. They directly take out the material, right? Or many of the students, they go to the secondary sources like annual report and other books written, and seldom they get an opportunity to. I prefer they should see the original inscription itself. If not, they should try to see the beautiful facsimiles given in Epigrapha Indica, Corpus Inscription Indicarum, or Indian Antiquary, or any of the epigraphical publications. So this is a very, very important area where normally the students miss. Even as a heritage enthusiast or whatever I should say, we cannot isolate epigraphy from archaeology or art history, anything. It is all part of it. I have seen many of the students or the visitors, they go around the temple and rarely even, less alone they appreciating the sculptures or the art or architecture, seldom they are drawn into the area or they look into the epigraphs. In South India, it is of a different context. When you go around this temple, inscriptions are carved all around, but in most of the temples in North India, you find inscription in a particular area, well chiseled and carved and kept. And how I got the prompt, you know, to speak about this calligraphical elements, this subject, calligraphy through the ages, was the topic suggested for the 150th year of Archaeological Survey of India. Different branches came out with different programs, and we were asked by the then DG to take up this calligraphy through the ages. So the Arabic and Persian inscription, a branch, then the dead had also preferred this, and I was also asked to look into the most of the inscriptions which has some ornamentation or calligraphical elements. So this was altogether a new subject for me, and really I was astonished when I could go through most of the Epigraphy Indica volumes. I could find a large number of inscriptions, especially ranging from the 6th century Common Era to the 10th century. There are a number of inscriptions, not only Siddhamatrika, even its progression when we see in early Nagari, there are large number of inscriptions with lot of ornamentation or calligraphical elements in that. So this, after this, in my presidential address for the Epigraphical Society of India, I chose this subject. There were two subjects. One connected with the problems and perspective in epigraphy, and another aspect is the calligraphical elements. Other than this is the first time I'm trying to talk about on this calligraphical elements. Normally, when we see, you know, calligraphy is a subject, you know, immediately strikes us Arabic and Persian inscriptions. But when we look into our vast, India is a country, you know, very rich in epigraphical wealth. Throughout the length and breadth of the country, hundreds and thousands of inscriptions are found and written in various scripts, Brahmi and its derivatives. I would like to give a very broad chronological framework of the inscriptions written in Brahmi. Early Brahmi, from beginning from 3rd century BC to the 3rd century Common Era, that is the early Brahmi state. Then again 4th to 6th century as the late Brahmi inscriptions, and 6th onwards we have 6 to 8 or little further Kutilar Siddhamatrika. And if I go a little back, we have the boxeted characters. I also consider it is as a unique type of writing created by the desire devised by the Vakatakas and further rulers in central India, followed the tradition of getting their copper plates and stone inscription written in boxeted characters. And also equally so is the nail-headed characters, that's also formed, which has a bit of calligraphical element in this. And apart from that, there is a very unique variety of inscription called shell character inscription or Shankulipi, which normally are found from 6th to 8th century and mostly northern India and eastern northern India we find. That's a very, very important area where you find the strong presence of calligraphical elements in the shell character inscriptions. Thanks to Professor B.N. Mukherjee, who could pave the way, key to understand that. But unfortunately, large number of inscriptions, shell character inscriptions, are documented, not deciphered successfully. And his disciple Richard Solomon also made some efforts, but still we have to decipher this shell character inscription more successfully. So till 10th century, that is again from 6th to 10th, we have large number of inscriptions. And mostly earlier inscriptions, you know, from 3rd century BC to 3rd century AD, we have Prakrit inscriptions. Again, by the beginning of the 1st century Common Era, we have emergence of Sanskrit inscriptions. And the Sanskrit inscriptions, as you know, it's found, there is no, I mean, it is there in the medieval, late medieval period as a language. It continued all along with the other regional languages too. So Brahmi is considered as a pan-Indian script, and Sanskrit is considered as a pan-Indian language. So we are looking into those inscriptions, especially from 6th to 10th century, and I am trying to make an effort because it's my perception, and it is defined. Calligraphy means that which looks beautiful, not necessarily highly ornamental. So calligraphy is something which looks impressive or attractive. So in that sense, I would like to even consider the Rumindi pillar inscription of Ashoka. You may wonder why I'm looking at this. When you look at the large number of Ashokan rock edicts, and particularly when you see the pillar edicts, especially the Rumindi I'm mentioning, it is one of the first basic things when we teach to early Brahmi students or Indal make to study. So when they make a beautiful polished stone and beautifully they engrave the, when they impart the beauty, you know, you can see equally spacing, equally giving attention to the each limb, each part of the letter. Even why not we consider the beginning of little bit of, in a nascent form, the calligraphical element could be seen even in the Rumindi pillar inscription itself, when you see, because in an inscription, as you know, there are, when we speak about the format of the inscription, I will leave alone the first part. Normally, in the end of the inscription, we get the composer. The, who is the composer of the inscription? His name is mentioned. Then the writer of the inscription, writer or scribe, and the engraver. So these are the three persons who are involved in this and whom we have to look into now in this today's talk. The scribe occupies a very supreme position as an engraver. As I said at the beginning, we look at the epigraphs only from its contents. Hardly we look into how an inscription looks like, whether it is in box-headed characters, nail-headed characters, or Siddha Matrika characters. Especially in the earlier volumes of Epigrapha Indica, even the progression, when the concept of, I think, the Kutila or Siddha Matrika was not very, very clear. So they call it even early Nagari. But now it is very evident. We call certain, some of the inscription with angularities and the with a very good vowel sign, we call it Siddha Matrika or Kutila script. So when you read some articles in Epigrapha Indica, you may even see it is mentioned as early Nagari. But the progression, that are, when you early Nagari, you know, gave up certain elements of Siddha Matrika, and some changes we see that. So the among them, you know, the composer, the engraver, the writer and the engraver. So here, most of the inscription, now we go to the contents. There may be many hundreds of inscriptions. We didn't give much attention. Who is the engraver? What are the qualities? I mean, what are the things he has tried to bring it in the inscription that we have to see? So with this big background, let me go to the introduction. See, the art of writing, you know, among the humanities, the art of writing has not given, taken or given the due place. That's what even David Derringer, in his both the books, The Alphabet and the Writing, he has expressed. In the humanities, the art of writing has not given many. We directly come to the antiquity of Indian writing and further. But seldom we go to the system of writing that prevailed in the ancient world by different system of writing. Anyway, that alone, Derringer says, among the greatest contribution to the mankind, more than the wheel or the fire, the art of writing is the greatest contribution to the mankind, without which now you can well imagine where we would have stayed without the writing. But when you closely observe how the man was inspired by the nature, by the fauna, by the flora, so the artistic conscience, you know, it is very much in human side. And that's what we find. It all made a beginning with the pictographic writing. I'm not going to the different forms in the evolution of the form of art of writing, but pictography. An artist may see in a different point. For him, you know, he want to convey, express himself in the form of pictography. That's what we see, which forms one of the main stages in understanding and further evolution. I'm not touching, but pictography is very important, which is very close to art. When we can understand and appreciate a beautiful sculpture, why not a beautiful art of writing? It's an art, art of writing. You don't see an epigraph only as a storehouse of some knowledge or some history written in that, but please look into the other aspects connected with the elements which has gone in making or scribing the inscription. He not only appreciated various art forms, but also allowed his ingenuity to play a great creative role in generating artistic expressions, as we see in many art forms. And art of writing is not an exception. The writer or the engraver closely followed his artistic intuition by creating ornamental forms. So, as I said at the beginning, in the epigraphical studies, particularly the calligraphy, it forms one of the important area, the artistic tradition which is solved, that is the calligraphy elements. So as we understand, calligraphy is a word which is normally associated with the Arabic and Persian inscriptions, and it is defined as a beautiful handwriting. Among the authors or the calligraphers, I should mention, see, Shivaramurthy's book mentions, or there is a brief introduction or a note in the introduction about the ornamental characters. And I have heavily drawn upon his work only, since I could not access many of the original inscriptions. The art, the high copy which is given both in the Gauri Shankar Oja and as well as this book by Shivaramurthy, there are very beautiful high copy of the inscriptions that one has to see and understand, not only the paligraphical aspects. And here I would like to mention here, all along the paligraphical development, there is an undercurrent of artistic tradition. You cannot see in isolation. See, scholars think it is paligraphy, the evolution of the letters. But all along the evolution, there is an element of calligraphy, and that is what the scribe, you know, he worked upon. In fact, when we say the Eastern, the Kushan, the Eastern or Western variety, but especially, you know, we can say stylistic differences, even within the varieties, the Eastern or Western, whatever, when it goes to the hand of an engraver, he took his own liberty to make some beautiful writing in his own way. So here I would like to mention the varieties, what we call the Eastern variety, Southern variety, Northern. But within that realm, the codified or the standardized forms, stylistic differences we see when it comes to the element of calligraphy plays, you know, we have to see stylistic differences. So that the engraver, the scribe, you know, took command or advantage, and he did his own thing. Of course, retaining the original forms. He may try to form in a different way the vowel sign, E sign or U sign, all different. But this, I think, most of you may agree, it is the stylistic difference. So all along the palligraphical tradition, we find the undercurrent of the calligraphical element, which is the. And mostly epigraphs are studied from the point of view as a source to understand our history. Secondly, inscriptions are studied to understand the palligraphical aspects. In the beginning, epigraphists were more seriously concerned, and they did refer about the palligraphical aspects or orthographical aspects or something connected with that. Even an ornamental script like Kutila, they never dealt much upon that, except making a brief reference about it. But there is no detailed study of the calligraphical elements in that. So scholars had a different this one. So there is at least, we have 4 centuries, starting from 6th to 10th century, whether it may be in Madhya Pradesh or Uttar Pradesh or Rajasthan, Guhila. See, most of the dynasties from that 4th century, they produced enormous beautiful inscriptions. Especially, that's what I request the students and the scholars, just to don't only see the content of the inscription or the text or the translation or the details. Please slowly, closely examine the facsimile, beautifully inscription. That is a way of learning also. And as you rightly mentioned, when I was teaching epigraphy and calligraphy, more than the students, I was rather eager to teach when it comes to the Kutila or Siddhamatrika, because I could easily draw. I could make, that gives a pleasure. See, mere reading, mere seeing doesn't good. When you see an inscription, just try to draw it. You will have a pleasure from that. When you try to draw an angular form or the artistic curve, you feel you are something, get into the artistic way of doing things. So please, this is a message I want to give to the students. Just don't only see the other details connected with the inscription. Closely see the epigraph from the other point of view, palligraphy, and closely well-knit forms like calligraphy also, which is a part of the inscription. So a close examination of the early inscriptions, the different engraved in Romic characters, so they reveal the subtle presence of artistic value in them. So it is intended here to convey or draw the attention of the scholars that all along the palligraphical development, there was an undercurrent of element of artistic writing. One can see subtle element called beauty, which can be seen in the inscriptions at all periods and all regions. Even when I visited Bhuri Singh Museum, you see they have many inscriptions. And even the Sharda script, we have got very beautiful inscriptions. Even a simple inscription uniformly engraved with due attention given to each limb of the letter with proper alignment and space is also most appealing. That's what I brought to you, or I showed you. Even the Rimindi pillar inscription, especially pillar inscription, you might just see the difference. On a boulder, the same early bronze Mauryan Brahmi gives a different thing, and it's difficult. But the work of the engraver, when it is polished to stone and beautifully it is engraved, even rather you can admire even the early Brahmi inscription of Ashokan period, how beautifully they have engraved it. So irrespective of the period to which the inscription belonged, The scribe who writes the inscription is very important, who imparted beauty to the inscription. And now I am coming to a very important phase, that is the beginning of the first century Common Era, with the advent of the Shaka Kshatrapas. As Dhani remarks in the book, they brought with them the pen technique. See, earlier inscriptions, they used stylus or chalk and all. But here, in the beginning of the first century, Common Era, with the advent of the Shaka Kshatrapas, they brought a technique called the pen technique. That is, they held the pen and draw the line, stroke, giving a gentle stroke. They elongated the stroke. And they consciously, they made a small beginning, you know, head mark in the evolution of the letter or in the calligraphical element, especially the head mark has a very, very important artistic look. Apart from aligning the word or the line, whatever may be, it gives a special significance. I will show you some of the pictures, some of the inscription. So there is a paradigm shift to place with the introduction of pen technique. This technique altogether gave a different look to the script, and the process of evolution was started, ultimately led to the ornamental writing. The post-Gupta period witnessed the phenomenal changes from 6th century Common Era to the 10th century. Normally we say the 6th to the end of 8th century or the beginning of the Siddhamathaka characters, but even in its progression, in early Nagari also retained the certain characteristic features of the Siddhamathaka in the early Nagari phase also. So normally it gives a beautiful look. So scribes, engravers reveal their ingenuity and give free vent to their creativity. See, they had that, the composer has given the text, the writer, of course, he has the knowledge of the script, he writes. Perhaps here we have both the writer and the engraver has a very, very unique place or their role in creating beautiful letters. Ornamentation was its cusp, with various floral desire bursting forth from the top of the letters. When you see, especially when I take you to the beautiful calligraphy ornamental letters found in the Kailasanatha temple, you will really admire how they formed the foliages and the somewhere the peacocks surrounding. So much of artistic work that we will see in the letters. And another equally important is shell characters, Shankulipi, which I mentioned earlier. And there, you know, the core of the letter is the Brahmi, early or late Brahmi only, but they camouflage the letter in such a way it went in different, but you have to hold in a different orientation to decipher. So that's why scholars are still making, but perhaps after Mukherjee, there is no very serious students taking up. So here also, I would like to mention, we need a second and third line of scholars, epigraphists mainly, dedicated, who could do a lot of research work in the area of calligraphy. Whether you take Dhani, our earlier scholars, we have works which are written more than 50 to 60 years before. Now, a large number of inscriptions have come to light or even coming to light, but they need to be subjected. Many of the views or many of the forms and eye copies, they have to be reread or seen from the inscription that have come to light in the last so many decades. So with their knowledge, even I should say the Gauri G.H. Oja's book is such a monumental work for even after a century. Even now, this is the most sought after book for the epigraphies, for the calligrapher, and it is such a work that he has created. Even now we refer, like T.C. Sarkar Indian epigraphy, or Dhani's Indian calligraphy. These are the best books so far created by them. So here, in the shell character also gave a dexterous hand to move with equal, you know, high fluidity. And creativity saw no bounds in forming the letters. He took its own passion and gave the best artistic view. So as I told, I am entirely focusing here. The subject is such, the scribe or the engraver occupies a paramount position in our today's lecture. Without him, we can't see, you know, the composer gave, but it is only the writer or the engraver who has given the best. In our study, the scribe occupies a unique place. In some of the lithic and copper plate inscriptions, scribe finds a special mention. So we think of Allahabad pillar inscription, or Ravikirti, or Kubja, like that, you know, very, very important inscription. We take the name of the scribe, but when we examine a large number of inscriptions, copper plates, there may be many more great scribes which we have not noticed properly in the course of our study, or they are not given due importance. So the scribe occupies a very important place. Not only that, he boasts of himself, he could create the best of the inscriptions. Ornamental letters were often written with greatest dexterity by scribe. It is always considered the scribe's writing was distinctly superior. I would like to see in the play Mudra Rakshasa, the Chanakya, he expresses that even a Kshatriya like him would be far from clear, and he prefers the services of a scribe. So here, when draft is prepared, he admires, appreciates when it is prepared by, written by a scribe. So in the play Mudra Rakshasa, we have an allusion to this. Scribe, the role or the place the scribe occupies. As far as epigraphs are concerned, we come across like Raja Lekathas. We, such expressions are common. Raja Lipikaras. See, they are this one. There are many inscriptions, prashastis, copper plates, where a king or, is, you know, royalty, they got it done. But when you visit some other place, maybe belonging to Chandela or Paramera, there are many pilgrim records where they got it. So that's why even Dr. Ramesh observed the local strain, the rustic strain, he calls, in the writing. So when it is same prepared as a prashasti, they all attention, all will be given. But if it is carelessly, there are many early records also. So this is what the earliest reference to Lipikara. As you know, Chapada we find from Brahmi, from Brahmagiri and Siddhapura versions of it. Is the earliest reference to a Lipikara, Chapada, who writes in his way, since he hailed from the northwestern region, he was more conversant with the Saraushti script. That's why he writes in the form. Some of the epigraphs stands as a testimony to the fact had extraordinary skill in executing records. They took their work. So here are some inscriptions where we find the specific mention of the scribe. Absurd inscription of Aditya Sena mention a certain Sukshma Shiva hailing from the Gowda region, and he is eulogized, and he could give letters beautiful Vikataakshara. He could write beautiful writing. Similarly, we have another reference. A scribe from Vijayawada the engraver of the charter of the Chalukyan king, Varadendra Mrigaraja, whose style is had the epithet Akshara Lalita Acharya. He had the epithet Akshara Lalita Acharya, expert writer of beautiful letters. It is usual to compare letters clear and distinct to pearls and gems in Indian languages when it is very beautifully written. And Mahidhara, another scribe known from an inscription from Bhuvaneshwar, compares the letters to the stars in the sky, just like beautiful stars in the sky, these letters. Another Sutradhara named Sahila describes his letters as real resembling goddess Lakshmi, goddess Saraswati in his inscription. And again, another from the south, a scribe named Sarvarashi, Kovarashi, boasts himself that could entwine forms of elephant, lion, parrot, and many other forms as to shine among the letters. You find, you know, there are certain letters which are beautifully carved. And for our particular talk, you know, Kutila or Siddhamatrika has the greatest significance. They are found in very different forms. So there is a very interesting allusion, Kutilaksharani, in the great work Vikramanka Deva Charita Bilhana. And there in that work, Queen Suryamati states that she does not allow herself to be cheated or accepted by writers using crooked alphabets. Kayastehi Kutila Lipibihi. So that's what Bueller has tried to make a point right in the Indian Antiquary article. And the knowledge of Kutila, or it's called crooked letter, considered attainment. Kutilaksharani Vidushai, Vidushai, that is for the scholars. They were experts, they could write in Kutilakshara. These are the reference we get. And the script termed Kutila Lipi by James Prinsep is none other than what earlier references we find in the literature also. Chai? So now I am coming to some of the illustrative portion of my talk. As I was, am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are.
Yeah. There are three distinctive features which we see. One is the vertical stroke, lengthening the vertical stroke. The stroke is shown here, and with a head mark made above. And this is a little open box at type, and this is filled in, and this is open. So these are the various head marks and the elongation, what you find in the vertical stroke, that gives a more calligraphical effect. And that what we see even the letter R here, and the stroke is extended with a gentle curve, and sometimes it takes a deeper curve. And letter Ra plus two strokes forming U sign, and this is Pa with the Pu and Ku, Ka. And the medial vowel signs also has its own significance here. Here, Siri, Swasti, Shri, Maha, Raja, Kushali. You can see here how beautifully the angularities we see in this Ma. And you see the vowel signs here, E sign taking a curve. And especially Shri is written in a different way. And you can see these are all within the varieties, the stylistic representation that was mentioned, Kushali, see, these are the things here. And this, of course, you can see in the Professor Dani's book, the medial vowel signs are very unique. And you can see here from North India and how the lengthening of the sign, and these are the things which I would like particularly like to draw the attention, the Banskeda copper plate inscription here. He, see the stroke, and the they have created on stroke, added on stroke to get the E sign here, and Pu, E sign. These are very artistic in their creation, like to love like this. Very beautiful way of writing. And in the south, are there, especially the last two, three step Pallava inscriptions, which I am going to show some of the photographs you can see here. The Pallava Grantha also equally very beautiful, and equally they also have the Siddhamatrika characters, especially you see in the Athirana Chandeshwara temple. Not only that, even the Kaisala Kailasanatha temple, first you find the inscription written in the Siddhamatrika characters, and then followed by the Pallava Grantha script, and lastly highly ornamental form. It is Kuttila only, but very highly ornamental, highly ornamental thing. So these are the things who would like to pursue or appreciate this, I think would may refer to the book written by Dani, that he elaborates certain aspects of this. And these are the some of the I copy which are made. Yeah, here you will see the stroke here. Especially I would like to draw the attention of the viewers here. See the re, one curve entire, and here some sort of artistic element he has brought in between to give a different look. And he, actually this would have been enough, but he has tried to add one more curve here to give he. Similarly, this one stroke followed by another stroke, and these are two, when they attach more stroke, which add some foliage and all this. And see here, Namah Shivaya, Om Namah Shivaya, and Shri. So this I have tried to make some, I copy from the Shivaramurthy's book. So earlier in my talk, in the beginning, I was referring, even the Ashokan edict, Rubindi pillar inscription, you see individual letter, there is a space between, and the letters are very uniformly, they you say the entire alignment, and the space in between the lines, and the space. So the very appearance, you know, it gives, so the beauty, the concept of beauty, very much there, even the earlier inscription also. It may look symmetrical, it not necessarily having all high ornamentation, but a simple look when it has got an element, little bit of calligraphy, you can see the artistic, his trend you can see in this. And this is a very, very important inscription, both from the evolutionary aspect as well as from the calligraphical aspect. I was mentioning, you know, the introduction of the pen technique in the beginning of my talk. And this is the Mathura inscription of Shodasha, where you see a small head mark, make a beginning here, and the card, Swamisya Mahakshatrapasya Chandasasya, like that it goes. So the beginning, what the 3 centuries, you know, from first 3rd century BC to the end, you don't see much even Shunga. There are very small differences are there, but this is a very, very important stage when they brought the technique. And not only that, you find the elongation of the vertical and the vowel signs and the conjunct letters. You see, Sya, they elongated the stroke and added Ya, Sya, Tra. Like that, you see Sya here. They extended the vertical stroke and then conjuncted this. It's a very important thing. Of course, Maharoli pillar inscription also. See, it is so majestic. When you see the pillar, see here the monumental variety of the Gupta face, where thick head mark and the letters are very beautiful in this way. It's slightly chronologically not so well arranged here. I'm showing anyway, but the Kadambas, they got, I mean, apart from their routine copper plates and all, well, they have very beautiful stone inscriptions also. This Banavasi inscription of Mrigesha Varman is very beautiful, you see here, especially the lengthening the strokes here, and the vowel sign, you know, the E is taking and giving a curve, and yeah, see here, this. So when you see individual letters, more than when you see a whole inscription, it has got that element of calligraphy. When you see, these are some early inscriptions from this one, and this is again Nagarjanakonda inscription of Ikshwaku period. In the last, you can see here, they have extended the line here, Rajna Siri Veera Purisa Datasa. So this, you see how beautifully, you know, and they have given equal space to accommodate the vertical stroke, long stroke, and not only that, they have taken the upper stroke also almost to that same length and given a curve here for E. So you can the stroke, vertical stroke below, and even the stroke above, extending it, and they are given. So this gives a bit of, see here, Siri Veera Purisa Datasa, like. And the ka, letter ka, this one. And this, of course, is a Banskeda copper plate inscription. And you can see the high flourishes, you can see this record. I'm going to a little earlier phase. See these Kanishka's period, where you can see Bhikshus, yeah. See that the stroke, you know, they extended it, and the angularity you can see here. No doubt, calligraphy is one aspect, and they try to give a sort of beauty to this writing. And the Guhilas, especially, you know, there are many, many beautiful records. And you can see here, this Sri Guhilanvaye, Sri here, see the stroke here, and the Raja, all lengthening, you find, just like other half, like a feather top, you know, tip attached to it. And here you see here, all beautiful letters formed here. See, ko, ka sign, and this, how they are formed. They are very beautiful. in this sense. Again, I'm going to earlier, and here you can see little Siri V Dirgha here, Purisa Dattasa. Again, Ikshvaku period. And this Mandasura inscription of Yashodharman, this is considered a little earlier stage to the beginning of the Siddhamatrika characters. Especially want to draw your attention, when they try to draw Tya, not only confined to the simple that letter, even the Ya sign, you know, goes up to the three letters. See the stroke. Such the inscriptions we find here. You see here, this extending that Ya, which covers almost 2-3 letters, is very interesting. And this is of Mandasura inscription of Yashodharman, very beautifully engraved. And again, with the solid head marks you find here. And this inscription of Maharaja Lakshmana, you can see the head mark here. They have kept it open here. Highly angularized Swasti, Va sign, how is there? Again, E. So you can just see the head mark. Just they have kept the open, this one. Maheshwaraha Sri, like that it goes here. So just I want to bring that from right from 6th century common era to the 10th century, you have got Gupta early Nagari inscription written in various forms. One is the varieties, and here I want to emphasize the stylistic forms which the scribes, you know, they followed in writing and engraving. And this Asirgad seal of 7th century, Sharvavarman, later Maukari ruler, you can see here beautiful. And here again I can show you this Ya sign. At least when they extend it, it gives a calligraphical effect. Chatus Samudra Adikranta, like that it goes here. The text I am not reading. See, especially the vowel signs and the conjunct Ya, which is taken almost to cover 3-4 letters here, is gives a calligraphical effect. And again, this is an early inscription from the south. Banavasi, it is there. See here how they have extended the letter here. Rajna with a head mark here, and then they have taken a curve and then Nya, Rajna. So this. And again, from the south, there are very beautiful inscriptions belonging to the Hoysalas. Sometime in the copper plate, some of their stone inscription, especially the beginning, the beginning, where they made enough space, you know, to give the calligraphical elegant, this one, Namastunga Siras Chumbi. See here, they brought in between the some swan and some this features. See here. And this is one of the A copy which I got, and I am showing some original stone inscriptions also. Sri Kalanka Rahitaha. See here, the birds are shown here. Sri Kalanka Rahitaha. And what are all the highly ornamental way of writing which you found in the Kailasanatha temple. Again, the rock inscription of Swami Bhatta, you can see here the, again the conjunct forms here. Ya, extension, then it's very beautiful. I don't have a very good facsimile of the inscription. Again, this is the most cynosure of this this one, today's Harsha's signature. Swahasto Mama Maharaja Dhiraja Sri Harshasya. And how beautifully it is written here. See, and the floral design that burst, that comes through the top of the head mark here. You can see here and here. It's all beautifully. Raja Dhi, this is Dha. Isha Indra have brought it in such a way and have brought wonderful calligraphical element in this. Again, this I was mentioning the box-headed character. When you see a copper plate, it do has some little of calligraphy. You can see here the box head on this distinct way of writing, though have the Brahmi characters. And this is the shell character inscription. I was mentioning there are number of many hundreds of shell character inscriptions have come to light, but it's rather very difficult. You find the core letter, and these are all the superficial, this one, marks, you know, either maybe vowel E sign or YAR, very difficult. It takes a little more time, but they have been documented, but some serious scholar should further indulge in this area to study these shell character inscriptions. Again, the Talagunda inscription, it's a very beautifully, and this letter, Nagari inscription, you see here how beautiful, you see the head marks and all. It's a late inscription, 10th century, little Nagari of later phase. It's also very important. And this again, an early inscription. And you see the sheer calligraphic elements which has gone in the vowel marks and the conjuncts and this thing. Again here. Again, Jalrapattan, another this. I took the I copy from the one of the volumes of Indian Antiquary. I don't know where the original stone lies, but it's a very beautiful inscription in this. Again, I was mentioning this Shravana Balagola inscription, where you find the Shaka. You see the upper stroke, you know, the top letter line running with lot of calligraphical elements that has gone in. I have shown the upper. And these are the ones last few days before I visited the Kailasanatha temple, incidentally. And I was saddened to see most of the inscriptions are getting worn out and they are not getting the due attention. I mean, it is a sandstone, you know. And by just seeing, you know, he has used a very sharp, a stylus-like thing. You can see a thick head mark here on both the part portion of the link and extended line, and these are the beautiful elements of calligraphy that has gone in this. All are the Birudas of the Pallava, great Pallava rulers here, and it is getting worn out, and the engraving is not that deep, so it's peeling, it is coming off here. And you can see the Shri here, letter Shri, one stroke below, and it is, and the sign is attached here. And these are some more inscriptions. I will just make a quick look. These are very important unique, which I specifically copied for this today's took photographs for the lecture. See here, beautiful. See the how beautiful it is there, red mark and the E sign and the Shri. You can see simply Shri itself written in many, many forms, adding strokes and creating that C just like that. And Ja, A sign, it is one stroke gone in and he has added more strokes here. So this, see here, very thin, sharp instrument, stylus he has used to carve these letters. See. So, I want to draw the attention mainly of the students. When they visit the monuments, hardly they look into the inscriptions that are around, whether it is in Pallava Grantha or Siddha Matrika or Brahmi. So, please take a look of these beautiful inscriptions, and they are already documented, but some more care should be taken to preserve these things. Here, beautiful. Again, another stone with lot of flourishes around the letters. This I was made an eye copy here. Shri Kalanka Rahitaha. See here. This is a bird where it's the Shri letter is shooting from its beak, and here another side it is looking on it, and the bird is configured beautiful way. You can see the Kalanka Rahita, which I made an eye copy, and this the original inscription, how beautiful it is. So this is again the Athirana Chandeshwar and Mahabalipuram written in the Pallava Grantha characters. Again, the beauty is that, you know, the R is beautiful. See, Pallava Grantha is equally very good. And this is the Siddha Matrika characters. Rarely we have in South India, especially this of the 7th century Pallava period, where Siddha Matrika character inscriptions are very few. Even in Badam we have, which share some early Nagari having some Siddha Matrika characters. So this is the full view of the picture, the inscription. Again, a shell character inscription of this. See, this is again ornamental writing, Purnaditya. It is written Shri Purnaditya. Pu, who sign here? Purnaditya. Tya, you can see here, this. So, with this, I am concluding my talk on this calligraphical elements in Sanskrit inscriptions. This is the first talk I am giving on this subject. And here, you know, we can look for many more such beautiful inscriptions. Especially, I told you, know, the period ranging from 6th century Common Era to 10th century. If we go through all the Epigraphia Indica volumes, right from 1 to all the volumes available, I think many, many more such beautiful inscriptions could be documented, and they can be studied also. What are the trend, the style? Now I'm making a very clear distinction between the variety. Earlier paligraphers, they called the Eastern variety, Southern variety, but here within that standardized form, stylistic presentation. That is what my whole crux of the thought today emphasized, that style may dominate it, and the scribe, the calligrapher, took the utmost upper hand in doing the way he wanted to do. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for this beautiful session and for taking us through all the inscriptions that you presented. And I think we were like, you know, with you there at the site, exploring all the inscriptions, you know. So thank you so much for taking us through that journey. And it was truly a beautiful journey. And for also making us aware of, you know, epigraphs and for with inscriptions, because it is one of the least talked about subjects when we study history. So we have two questions for you. I think three questions now. Yeah. The first question is from Anurup Santri, and his question, sir, you mentioned about pen technique. Can you briefly elaborate on that and the previous techniques?
Yeah, that is the early Brahmi inscriptions, the Ashokan and the subsequent period, and the Brahmi inscriptions that are found in the 3rd century BC. See, they use that chalk and the hard, the engraved material, this is iron tool. But in the subsequent period, the entry of the Shodasha, that is Kshatrapas, how they know they brought that pen technique means they held, they read, even while writing the calligraphy, we use that pen. Normally, when you hold the pen, read pen, the upper stroke, when you hold the pen on the top, automatically some little head form, though not very consciously form, but they held the pen and drew it. The upper will be thicker, and when they elong it, it will be thinner. It tapers off. So this technique, where it came, how it, but they brought it, and subsequent dynasties, to some extent, they followed. And this is the very, very important, the technique which prevailed earlier to the this one, and the how the Kshatrapas they brought. This is very important. So this is a pen technique, which when you refer for more information, can you read the book written by Dani, Ahmad Hasan Dani on Indian calligraphy? A more elaborate account is given on this aspect.
Thank you very much, sir. The next question is from Urvashi Basak, and the question is, sir, what's the profound difference between ancient Indian calligraphy in ancient Indian languages, Sanskrit, and Muslim languages like Persian and Arabic? And did the Muslims too draw from nature in beautifying their scripts?
No, we cannot bring two things here. See, the language is different, the script is different. See, for Sanskrit or other regional language also, script is different. And I want to make a clear distinction. The Brahmi, late Brahmi, or its evolution is different. Sanskrit language is different. And we can't totally, in any way, see, we have biscriptal, bilingual, Arabic, Persian inscriptions also there, and there are bilingual inscriptions also there, but unfortunately, they are not in the calligraphy form. And here, it is entirely different. I am not bringing to, there are two distinct things. I'm using calligraphy with a word that which looks beautiful. That is the only thing. So we can't bring, there are two things apart. So no comparison here. So calligraphy is a different thing here, that which looks beautiful with a decorative aspect in it.
A question deals with if you can give a clarification on shell characters. So, does that mean the script is beautified with shell-like drawings?
Absolutely, because of the nature, the way it is written, Shankulipi. We translate it, it is also called Shankulipi. When it is letters are formed, no, it looks like a shell, whether in the oval forms or in this one, no, the entire, the small, they are all small writings, maybe some name of the mason or the art. They are not long inscription. Shell character inscriptions are very, having some 6, 7, 8 characters, but it definitely stands some name. But the because of the appearance, the look, they have given the name shell character. It's also called Shankulipi, but it's an area. Unfortunately, even in our epigraph brand, they have documented it. Many hundreds have been there, but very little efforts are there to decipher. We should follow the methodology or the key set by Professor Mukherjee and take it ahead in the decipherment so that many could be deciphered.
Yeah. So, sir, we have one last question, and this is also from Urvashi Basak. And her question is, when the engravers used to engrave the calligraphic script on the stones, did they use their own imagination or they had the calligraphic script of the scribe with them and they saw that and did the engravings?
No, this is our own imagination. What when I have seen hundreds of inscriptions, it's purely his imagination that has gone in. There is no codified thing, because perhaps the composer has given, here the writer also has written. I think a little more liberty the engraver has taken, adding some more strokes to the inscription to impart, to lend more beauty to the inscription. So it is the freedom he has taken. I think each inscription looks different. When we just see, I have shown so many inscriptions, it is the little liberty which has taken the engraver in creating this. There is no such set thing. The core letter, he cannot do anything. But all you have seen, either in the footmark or the headmark, the vowel sign, adding one stroke and making that the engraver has taken his own liberty in this.
Yeah, and the most beautiful example of that is the last picture that you showed, the Kailashnath temple.
Yes, that is the most beautiful inscription we have on this. Fortunately, I had only an e-copy. When I visited a few days before, I could take some of the pictures, and that is the ultimate in this to show. So the main message of this today's talk is that the student should look into the facsimiles of the inscriptions given, so that don't just read the article or the text or the summary or the translation. Please take a look of the facsimile. If possible, when you visit the original place where inscriptions are there, don't just look into the architectural, sculptural, other point, but let's see the inscriptions also and enjoy, have a feel of it, and that is there. So in that way, you have taken a great root, you know, heritage. So epigraphy also forms one of the very, very important, the history. We are covering very, very aspects. I think many more talks should go on connected with epigraphical studies. That is the need of the hour. We need the serious students to come up to take up this study.
Definitely, sir. And we'll surely do that. Thank you so much, sir, for taking our time from your schedule to do this lecture this evening.
You readily responded, readily agreed to take up this, that I am very happy. And it came, the subject also. There are many subjects which could be taught, but this is the first thing. I thought I should draw the attention, the scholars and others who are viewing, to this specific area, so that they could go into the deeper aspects of this and understand, and more a volume, a book also could be brought out if mine on the calligraphy elements in the inscriptions.
Indeed, so and we'll surely do our best to, you know, promote this field of study among students. Thank you so much, and thank you so much, everybody who joined us live on Facebook. The lecture will be available on YouTube, so don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, share the video, like the video, and do
it's
share your comments.
On the YouTube.
Yes, it will be available by tomorrow. So thank you so much, and have a great evening.
Thank you again, Sharma ji. Thank you.